Good evening, everyone. I'm glad everyone's having a great time socializing, but I was told I had to start the meeting. Well, good evening, and welcome to our February 5th, 2020 meeting of the City Council. And before we start, for the invocation, could I please have Jack Marez come forward from the Word of Life?
Thank you, Mayor. Heavenly Father, we thank you for keeping your hand of protection over this city of Los Banos and its citizens. And we ask you, Lord, for the men and women that you have placed in the leadership roles governing and protecting this city. Heavenly Father, we ask you to bless this city council meeting tonight. Give our mayor and city council members the wisdom and knowledge to make the right decisions concerning the safety and well-being of all the citizens of this community. Heavenly Father, we ask your protection over our police and fire department personnel, our emergency medical responders, and all others who provide helpful services needed in this community. And we pray this in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to call to order the February 5th, 2020 meeting of the Los Banos City Council. And Chief, would you lead us in the flag salute?
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, item three, Director Maloney, roll call.
Faria, Johnson Santos,
here.
Jones,
present.
Lewis,
here.
Belalta.
Here, we do have a quorum. Let's go on to presentations. Item five, proclamation recognizing February as Teen Dating Violence Awareness and Prevention Month. And tonight we have with us Laura Olson from Valley Crisis Center, who is going to receive the proclamation. Laura, would you come forward, please?
Be right there.
Oh, good, it works. Thought maybe we had to ask Sonia for batteries again. Oh. Proclamation recognizing February as Teen Dating Violence Awareness and Prevention Month. Whereas teen dating and violence in its own various forms of control and abuse is a serious crime with the potential to destroy lives of those impacted. Teen dating violence involves physical, sexual, verbal, emotional, economic, and other abuse behavior, including harassment of various forms of cyberbullying with an intent to harm, threaten, harass, and control, or isolate another person with whom they have had or had a dating relationship with. During early teen experiences, new and complete emotions can result in a victim misinterpreting certain behaviors displayed by a dating partner, such as obsessiveness and impulsive actions as affection. Dating violence can have lifelong negative health effects, such as depression, suicidal thoughts, eating disorders, poor performance in school or work, risky sexual behaviors, drug and or alcohol abuse. California has focused on teen dating violence issues through effective measures and actions, including websites, social media initiatives, and public awareness campaigns, such as, what is that, loveisrespect.org. Now, therefore, be it proclaimed that the mayor and the city council members of the city of Los Banos do hereby proclaim February as Teen Dating Violence and Awareness Prevention Month and urge all citizens to show support for organizations and individuals who provide critical advocacy to victims and promote public awareness and teen dating violence. And it's not just after the fact. It's to promote healthy lifestyles and to give young people the proper tools that they need in order to go through adolescence in a positive manner and not in a negative manner. So thank you so much for what you do, Lara.
Thank you very
Thank you so much.
Can I just add, do I have a microphone?
Yes, you get your own.
I've actually been with Valley Crisis Center for about 8 years now, and for the past 4 years, I've had the opportunity to work just with youth primarily. And I actually teach a healthy relationships class at Los Banos High School, letting them know the warning signs and communication skills to keep them out of this. But the numbers are still staggering of how much we still see, you know, every day. We have a support group at the high school now, too. So we just thank you all for your continued support.
Thank you. And please don't be a stranger and come back and visit us. Thank you. Okay, bye.
You know what I didn't do? So let's go back. I'm going to go back to number four, consideration of approval of agenda. Do I have a motion? Mrs. Santos.
I'd like to make a motion to approve agenda as stated.
Mrs. Lewis.
Second.
Thank you. Motioned by Santos, second by Lewis for the approval of the agenda. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition? None. Carried. Okay, let's go on to item five, public forum. Members of the public may address the City Council members on any item of interest that is within the jurisdiction of the City Council, which includes agenda and non-agenda items. No action will be taken on non-agenda items, and speakers are limited to a five-minute presentation. Detailed guidelines are posted on the Council Chamber informational table. And when you approach the podium, please state your name and your city of residence. If you have a cell phone, please place them on vibrate or turn them off. Okay, is there anyone who wishes to speak at the public forum? Not seeing or hearing anyone, I will now close the public forum, bring it back to council level, and we will go on to item seven, consideration of approval of the consent agenda. Items on the consent agenda are considered to be routine and will be voted on in one motion unless removed from the consent agenda by a city council member. And tonight we have?
Items on the consent agenda are as follows. Warrant numbers 219954 through 220239. In the amount of $2,011,008.89. Second quarter investment report for the 2019-2020 fiscal year. Minutes for the January 15th, 2020 City Council meeting. City Council Resolution Number 6176, approving, authorizing, and ratifying the city's participation in the Homeland Security Grant Program and authorizing the city manager on behalf of the City of Los Banos to enter into the standard grant assurance agreement with Cal OES and a subrecipient agreement with the County of Merced and accepting state Homeland Security Grant Program excess funding in the amount of $18,943.41 and amending the 2019-2020 fiscal year budget by increasing the appropriation amount for expenditures and revenues in the amount of $18,943.41. City Council Resolution Number 6177, accepting the 7th Street Ballpark restroom project as complete and authorizing the filing of a notice of completion with the Merced County Recorder. City Council Resolution Number 6178, accepting the 2019 Street Rehabilitations Project as complete and authorizing the filing of a notice of completion with the Merced County Recorder. And City Council Resolution Number 6179, accepting public improvements for Mission Village South Phase 3C for Stonefield Home, Inc. And the items are to be approved as submitted.
Thank you. Please let the record show that Mr. Faria has walked in. Welcome, Mr. Faria, at 7:10. Okay. We have consent agenda items. Is there anyone who wishes to remove a consent agenda item for discussion? And if not, do I have a motion? Mrs. Lewis?
Yes, Mr. Mayor, I'd like to remove item E of the consent agenda. And I'll make a motion to approve the consent agenda minus item E as submitted by staff.
Okay, we have a motion by Mrs. Lewis to approve the consent agenda as stated, minus item E. Is there a second for this? Mr. Jones?
Second.
Okay, motion by Lewis, second by Jones for the approval of consent agenda minus item E. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition? None carried. Mrs. Lewis, would you pop in again, please? There you go.
Thank you. Okay, this question is to our Public Works Director, and this is in regards to the 7th Street Baseball Park restrooms. On change order number one, there was extra work to stub out and cap a 4-inch and a 2-inch irrigation line for a specific amount of money. Is that just capping it off, or was that moving the line?
That's capping and removing and
rerouting?
Rerouting them around. And normally the city would do that, but they were out there working on it, and we couldn't stop them from their preparation because the restrooms were arriving in 2 days.
Okay. Okay, I thought it, because the agenda report just says that it was capped off. It doesn't say that it was moved or rerouted.
No, it was moved.
Yeah. Okay, all right, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Mayor, with that, I'd like to make a motion to accept item E of the consent agenda as submitted.
Okay, we have a motion by Mrs. Lewis, and before we ask for a second, that was quite a project. And I have to tell you that it was a great sight to see, having that crane come in and lower those two sections, and how beautiful that restroom is, if a restroom can be beautiful. But it was a project 25 years in the making. And now it is completed. We have honored a commitment to the fairgrounds that, quite frankly, took too long, but after it's completed, hopefully everyone is happy. And so thank you to the city of Los Banos for all the work and the engineering and everything else that you've done to get that done, because it's beautiful. Mr. Fachin.
In case you drive out there, there is a trench that's exposed. That's city work. And we have to wait until there's extra hot mix to do it. They just don't make hot mix just for that little bit of a trench. Yeah. So the city workers will do that. There is another sidewalk hard surface that we have to do between two fields, and that also will be city work because we're trying to cut back on the cost of that project. So the whole entire project's not totally done. What we contracted out is, though.
Well, I'll tell you, it's like rolling out a red carpet and concrete to get up to that restroom. It's beautiful. Okay, so could I please have a second for item E? Mr. Jones.
Second, please.
Okay, motion by Lewis, second by Jones, to approve item E as stated on the consent agenda. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposition? None carried. Okay, let's go on to item 8, public hearings. If you challenge the proposed action described herein in court, you may be limited to raising only those issues you or someone else raised at the public hearing described herein or in written correspondence delivered to the city at or prior to the public hearing. Public hearing. To receive public comment and consideration of approving and adopting a proposed amendment to Title 9, Chapter 2, Article 6 of the Los Banos Municipal Code, establishing a general government facilities development impact fee. Item 8A1, ordinance number 1178, amending Title 9, Chapter 2, Article 6 of the Los Banos Municipal Code, establishing a general government facilities development impact fee. And this is a second reading and adoption, and we are going to go to Director Fachin.
Thank you very much. Our recommendation is to open the public hearing to receive public comment on this new ordinance, close the public hearing, and adopt ordinance number 1178. This is the ordinance that went along with the previously approved, at the previous meeting, approved impact fee study and impact fee rates. And this just combines three fees, City Hall development fee, Corporation Yard development fee, and Community Center development fee into one fee known as the General Government Facilities Development Fee. That's all this really does, and this will, and we had no comment when we had the first when we had the public hearing on January 15th. So 60 days after this is adopted, all this fee will be collected per the development impact fee study that that the council adopted at the last meeting. So
okay, thank you. Okay, any comments from council at this time? Okay. Not hearing any. I will now open the public hearing on ordinance number 1178. Is there anyone who wishes to speak? Not seeing or hearing anyone, I will now close the public hearing, bring it back to council level. And we have two motions. We have to waive the second reading, we have the adoption. All right, who would like to do that? Mrs. Lewis?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'd like to make a motion to waive the second reading of ordinance number 1178 as read by title.
Mr. Freya?
I'll second that motion.
Okay, it's been motioned by Mrs. Lewis for the waiving of the second reading of ordinance number 1178 as read by title. And second by Mr. Faria. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition? None carried. Okay, let's go back to Mr. Lewis. I'll just punch that. Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'd like to make a motion to adopt ordinance number 1178 as read by title.
Mr. Faria.
I'll second that motion.
Okay, it's been motioned for the adoption of ordinance number 1178 and second by Mr. Faria. Director Maloney, roll call vote.
Faria?
Yes.
Johnson Santos?
Yes.
Jones?
Yes.
Lewis?
Yes.
Peralta?
Yes, carried unanimously. Okay, thank you all. Thank you, Mr. Fachin. Okay, let's go on to item 9, Parks and Recreation presentation. Public Works Director Fachin.
Yeah, well, tonight we have the pleasure of our Parks and Rec Operations Manager, Joe Heim, presenting a PowerPoint on some of the programs and some of the happenings we have in Parks and Rec Division.
Welcome, Joe.
Thank you. Thank you for allowing me to present the Parks and Recreation Division update. We've undergone a lot of changes in the last year, this fiscal year, and it's just always beneficial to kind of review it, but also look at what we're doing for the future. So I don't know if I get this.
We good? It's always good when I didn't do it. So, do you want laptop or room PC?
Laptop, I think.
Laptop? Okay. Oh, good. It just switched to laptop over here. I don't think it was you, Joe. So, okay. I'll just say it's in public. You didn't do it either. Okay.
Thank you for allowing me to present on our Parks and Recreation Division. So the first thing I'm going to start off with is really one of the most important and probably the most important thing that's happened to Parks and Recreation in a very, very long time, which is Measure H and the impact that it's made. Parks and Recreation is only a portion of Measure H, but what it's provided for the division has been very transformational. We received funding for parks from it, but as well working with the police department and Chief Breezy, which very appreciative of his support, we've been able to provide significant funding for youth programs, and that's one of the reasons why you see so many new family and youth-oriented programs that I'll be talking about tonight. As far as just the areas that Measure H has impacted Parks and Rec, it's everywhere. It's programs, it's park improvements, it's equipment, it's staffing. All those areas have significantly benefited from Measure H. And one thing that we try to do with Measure H, specifically programs, is we kind of created this Measure H logo, and we try to kind of brand Measure H to really show the support that this measure has provided us. So as far as some of the activities and improvements that Measure H has provided for us thus far and kind of upcoming is we had a party in the park in the fall at Ranchwood Park that had over 700 guests. It was a really fun night there. We also have a youth spring soccer league, our second soccer season of the year that's registering right now. We have a spring flag football league. We had a fall youth volleyball league that was very popular. We got 125 players for that for the first season out there and the first volleyball league that we've had with the city. We've had our 4-H STEM program going on since the fall and still ongoing. We'll have our Big Truck Day event coming up. We'll have Cocos and Cookies with Santa about last December, where our kids got a chance to meet Santa on back-to-back Saturdays and kind of an opportunity outside of breakfast with Santa to kind of have that Mr. and Mrs. Claus meeting. We started a teen group with our kickoff last week. We had 27 teens, which was an awesome turnout. We have our upcoming egg hunt that we'll be bringing back, which I know Parks and Rec did a number of years back, and so I'm looking forward to that one. And then within the parks, we just completed Meadowlands 2, which was something that the public really had asked for, and that was a playground repair for two sides of the slides, which is a very expensive repair. And so without it, this would have been a repair that we probably wouldn't have been able to make in the next couple fiscal years. And so it was just very important to have that. We just completed that last week. We'll have a volleyball court we'll be installing at City Park where players already play. They just wear it down to dirt right now. So we want to give them a better facility. Equipment-wise, we bought a ball field groomer for our fields. And there's countless other improvements. And when one thing that we did last year with the help of finance was set aside some funding for capital reserve to kind of build towards bigger projects. And lastly, and probably most important, was we were able to add a staff member from Measure H. And overall, we were able to add two coordinators to the Parks and Rec division, which is really like a monumental step for Parks and Rec. That brings us to three recreation coordinators, Amanda, Rob, and April. And they've been vital to all these programs that we've been doing. It's definitely not, I'm not out there doing every one of these things. It's these guys back at the community center that are really helping us. So, and then as far as in addition to kind of Measure H, we've also just continued to provide a lot of community programs, including Breakfast of Santa, which this year we had over 700 attendees, which is the most since the first year of the community center, which was 2010. And we've partnered with the Junior Warriors to provide jerseys. And we maxed that basketball program out, which is ongoing right now. We'll have, I think, our week 5 of games this Saturday. We opened Olivera back up, which I know many of you were able to attend the grand opening last June. And just several soccer groups have been benefiting from that. It's just been very highly popular out there. I'm sure you guys drive by it and see the players out there, but it's a nightly occurrence out there. And then just kind of going back to some of the park improvements and what we have upcoming, we were able to replace the Skylark Park playground. And we'll kind of be able to feature that at Arbor Day this on March 6th, here coming up in about a month. And we're finalizing Big Page's playground replacement, which is on West I. And you'll see an orange fence up there waiting for certification at this point. And we'll be able to really enjoy that one. That one's been a playground that's been down for quite a while. So pretty significant. Just kind of expanding on park improvements. Playground repairs have been a major emphasis for the division. And thanks to Mike O'Brien and Carlos Granillo, the staff and the staff that we have on the park side, we're back on track. Our park staff has been great in identifying our needs within parks, and we've been able to give them more resources, which has made a huge difference. We've made 18 major playground repairs in the last year, and I'm not talking about, oh, there's a loose bolt here or this or that. We're talking about plywood on slides, things like that, major issues that are not only a liability, but also just not what you want on your playground, not what you want in your community. And just for just kind of as an example, we've had some of these playgrounds that have dated back 10 years that have had some of these issues. And we just had Vineyards A down there in District 1. We just had a slide break. Well, we were able to make that order for replacement within 3 days. So you're going from 10 years to 3 days, which is it's really a testament to how far we've come and the work that the park staff has been doing. We'll have some upcoming replacements at Citrus 1 and Citrus 2. We replaced a couple swing sets. And playground chips have also been another area that we've made significant strides. Almost all of our playgrounds were low on playground chips. It just reduces liability for the city and of course, brings up the aesthetics of the park. I'd also like to talk about that we've received significant help from other divisions, such as streets that assisted with our fog seal of the community center main parking lot, restriping it. They also converted our lighting in Meadowlands Park and the rail trail to LED, which is going to save thousands of dollars. And just generally speaking, every division and department has had a hand in our improvement. William over on the ops side of Public Works, streets, wastewater, they all helped with that 7th Street project that wouldn't, those restrooms that are now flushing would not have happened without them. We've had all these staff changes that HR has helped us with, Measure H with finance and PD. I'm always keeping Mr. Vaughn busy with agreements. Stacy, of course, with our grants and fires always supported us with our events and building inspections. And we're even working with IT now with our camera upgrades. So just really wanted to recognize that since I've come on board that it's really been a you know, huge teamwork. And I think as a smaller division, that's pretty necessary for us to continue. I also wanted to, not to get too far off topic, but I wanted to recognize two of our Public Works employees who recently retired, Greg Pimentel and Mike Hill. Both of them are in Public Works. And you know, I hope that we can talk their successors into helping parks as well. And I wanted to recognize one park staff member, Letty Luna, who had retired in September. All three of these employees were with Public Works for over 30 years. And for me, I'm 31, so that's not not too bad. And I appreciate everything they did from the big stuff to the small stuff. And of course, thank the public as well. Sometimes we get negative feedback, sometimes it's positive, but it just been very supportive. We do continue to strive for improvement, specifically in areas such as tree care, restrooms, adult programs, revenue generation, and renovating some of our larger park facilities. These are all high priorities to us. Additionally, we do have some big projects that we are working on. So the 7th Street restroom, we're wrapping up, hopefully get the sidewalk going, but the restroom's in. Flushes, everything like that. And I'd like to thank Council, Alex, and Mark for that. That's the project that has been going on long before I even heard of Las Banas. And I think it'll really benefit the programs that use those fields out there. We did also receive our engineer's estimate and specs for the community center overflow lot, and we'll be discussing that here shortly over the next few weeks in terms of the future of that project. And I'll let Boys and Girls Club probably come and talk to you, but as far as kind of where they're at, they're working for a Creekside Middle School program here, I think, starting at the end of this month or in March, and they're already registering kids for that, so it's exciting on their end. And I've been happy to work with the new CEO, Virginia Hayward. As far as our parks master plan, which I know some of you were able to attend, it is well underway. I don't know, we're probably about the halfway mark or so, but we held stakeholder meetings in December. We had a highly successful meeting in January 9th at the community center. We had over 100 people attend that, so it was really a great turnout and definitely appreciative of everybody that was able to come out. We'll be holding our next meeting on March 17th at 5:30 at the community center. That is St. Patrick's Day, so wear green, I guess. We hope to have a huge turnout for the meeting, and I've been excited to work on this particular project. One of the best parts of the first meeting, I thought, was just the diversity of it. We had kids, you know, 15-year-olds, 12-year-olds. We also had seniors. We had adults. We kind of had everybody. We had differences in what their interests were. We had differences in where they were living in Las Banas. But they were all there, and they were all supporting each other on different parks projects. So it was very cool to see. One project that's been one of the things I get asked about the most is the dog park. We had a presentation back in July, I think it was, for the council here, and then we had a public meeting last summer as well for the dog park, and I will actually be meeting with our consultant, QK Engineering, tomorrow afternoon, so we'll be nearing a final estimate and design here shortly after that, and then we'll hopefully immediately begin work out at Ag Sports Complex out there. One area I'm hoping to hear back on is the per capita program. It's listed last there on the bullet. And it's a state parks funding mechanism for every Parks and Rec organization. It's from Prop 68. And this is for a single-use project, and it's $185,000. What we've been kind of waiting on is the allocation timeline. And so that's something that we're still working on, but we're hoping to utilize that for the dog park for additional funding. Back in November, QK was able to provide a preliminary design for the space at the Ag Sports Complex. This is not the final design, obviously, but I just wanted to kind of show it here. It is small to see here, but you can see there's a small dog area, kind of an entryway with a double gate. There's a water source for humans and dogs and a lot of trees for shade. Additionally, ADA connection to the front there where the parking lot is on the south side of the park. And then again, we'll have updates here shortly on that particular project. And then another project that I'd like to talk about is the Pacheco Park grant, which no, I have not heard back on yet, but it's one of the things that we submitted that's just very, very important to our parks. We submitted a grant to the California State Parks for the statewide parks program, grant program through Prop 68. To me, this grant is just amazing and an amazing opportunity for Los Banos, and I was really excited to work on it. We submitted in August, and we really started the process for this last March. This project really became one of our top priorities. We worked on it with a consultant to submit it, and she had actually submitted for a few other cities that she was consulting with, and she was talking about we had the most public meetings of anything that she submitted. And then as far as the project itself, we had 9 public meetings. The project itself is just something that I really, really believe in as far as the importance of it to the community. Pacheco Park is our center park. It has the schools next to it. It has the high school football stadium. It has the scout house, the library, the museum, karate classes, all sorts of stuff. So it's a really, really important project to us for a park that is on the older side. We included a splash pad, a playground, a veterans memorial, new trees, new pathways, a rec building, sports courts, all in an $8.5 million submission. And this grant is really great because it doesn't require a match, and the construction would be just a 2-year period following the award. Initially, we had been told a January award date you'd be notified in January. We had a site visit from the state in November, and they had kind of let us know that they got a lot of applications, I think about twice as many as they had anticipated, and they had said that probably looking more like a February, which still certainly could happen, but I did talk to the consultant today that said that she had thought it was going to be more like March. So hopefully we can hear back. But as far as my end, I'm happy to wait as long as we get it. If we do receive it, it'll be going immediate. We'll be going immediately with this project. And if we don't, there is a future round, and it has the same guidelines, thankfully, which would allow us to reuse all of our public meeting information and submission materials that we've used. We would obviously have additional meetings and discussion, but to be able to reuse that is very important. Additionally, we submitted for a tree grant through Cal Fire. I'll be presenting in greater detail on this particular grant at our tree commission next week. But this opportunity comes through Cal Fire and includes some primary elements, including an urban forest management plan, which you can kind of call as a tree master plan, planting 100 trees throughout 5 park locations, and funding tree care for training, for staff training. We submitted with no match due to our status as a disadvantaged community. This grant has multiple stages, and we have not heard if we're approved for the next stage. Just to kind of go over what an urban forest management plan is, it's not something that Las Banas has ever done before, but cities across California are completing them. Tracy is currently creating one. Merced just created one. And essentially, it will cover a 40 to 50 year plan with tree inventory and analysis, review of ordinances, establish tree canopy goals, and provide software for tree care tracking. This will improve our competitiveness for future CAL FIRE grants, which will allow us to pursue larger tree planting opportunities in the future. Additionally, we have, of course, upcoming events and activities, as always. I'd like to invite everybody to our Arbor Day event on March 6th at Skylark Park. This year, we're trying to add a little bit more fun to the event. We'll still have the program element for the certification of our Tree City USA status, but we'll also have our art contest, which this year is open to the public, and I believe the deadline is next Friday, the 14th. Arbor Day, we'll have fun activities, games. We're going to have some food out there while supplies last, but I'm hoping that it's a fun day out there. We're also looking forward to our spring and summer events, such as the egg hunt, which I know was popular in the past. We're also doing a big truck, kind of a big truck day, which is a toddler event, family event, to kind of explore the big trucks in our community. A dog park grand opening, hopefully, here when we get that built. And summer events, and we're trying to do a movie night at the park, and then some water features and things like that. So we also have sports, t-ball, spring training, spring soccer, and 49ers prep flag football. We'll be advertising our new rec guide here. We'll be releasing that in about 2 weeks. And so just constant new activities here. And so Parks and Recreation is located at the Community Center at 645 7th Street. That's where my office is. I'm happy to meet with any of you or meet with anybody from the public. I always enjoy talking about new ideas and new opportunities. I'd definitely like to thank Alex and Mark for their support and, of course, all the other groups that I mentioned tonight. I'm hoping that this is a lot of information for you guys because we do stay really very busy at the Community Center. We do still try to have a lot of fun. It is Parks and Rec, and I really want to thank all of our staff members in Parks and Rec. Are just vital to what I do, to what we do. So that's all. If there's any questions.
I know this council was very interested in meeting a year deadline for the summer of 2020 to open the dog park. Are we going to be able to do that?
I hope so. Yeah, I hope so. I'll know a lot more after tomorrow when we meet. But yeah, that's still the goal.
Please push it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. No, because you know we said a year, and we'd really like to meet that timeline.
That's what I'd like. Okay. I'd like to see it as well.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. And one other question: Big Page Park on West I. Mm-hmm. There's a temp fence around all the playground equipment. What, is that just for new sand? And
so where the playground's at this stage is the construction has completed. However, the orange fence is still up and it will remain up until we get our letter from you have to get a certified playground inspection and that'll come in the mail. So I'm hoping by the end of the week, but it could be early next week. And that's for liability purpose, legal purposes to have that certified.
Because my wife commented that you dug way down in order to put a padding in there that was fantastic for in case, God forbid, someone falls off the equipment.
Yeah, so there's a state and federal law as far as playground chip depth, distance from curb to playground, et cetera. And one thing at that park, it had old galvanized irrigation. And so one thing we had to do that was a little different than all of our other playgrounds that we put in is we had to reroute a couple of the pipes that were running too shallow. They were, two of them were exposed, one in the corner and one underneath the swing set. So that was also done as part of this project in order to get to proper certification standards.
Well, thank you very much. Okay, Mrs. Santos.
Thank you very much. I wanted to say thank you for coming in. I find your presentation very exciting about everything we've got going on and everything you've been able to do. So thank you once again. But I wanted to ask about partnerships. Have you been having a lot of residents coming to you about partnering up with about different activities? Because I know we have like an indoor soccer and then there's like a 3-on-3 basketball and things like that. Have you been finding?
Yeah, we have had a lot of support and I definitely am always open to it because it's helpful. So the indoor soccer is an instructor in the community that lives locally, San Morales, and then the 3v3 is also a local couple that runs that and And so that's just kind of the tip of the iceberg. We also have, you know, our 4-H partnership. We're constantly meeting with Boys and Girls Club. It's just constant, whether it be an individual or whether it be an organization in terms of our partnerships. But we're always looking for more.
Thank you very much.
Mrs. Lewis.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Joe, I have a couple of questions. Number one. Olivera Park, you know, we spent a lot of money upgrading that park for soccer purposes, and it really looks nice. And first of all, I want to thank you for all the things that you've been accomplishing here for the city of Los Banos since your tenure. But we were having problems. I'm not sure. I haven't gotten any calls recently of people jumping the fence and going in there and playing soccer when it wasn't open for teams or public use. Are we going to be putting any signage up, legitimate signage up, so that people understand that this park is available by schedule?
Yeah, so we did put up, I think in December, we put up some metal signs on the actual fencing that state that, as well as state the balls leaving the field issue that we had discussed in the summer with the backstop netting. There's also a banner, like a vinyl banner, as you enter the parking lot. That's I think it's 3 by 6 feet. It's on the. There's an old sign that where it talked about the construction project that we left the sign up, and we just put a couple banners on it, and that provides the phone number for Parks and Rec and discusses the rental aspect of it. But that is certainly a challenge for us. We do want to keep open nights in order for field rest. So that's important to us. But it is a challenge keeping people from jumping the fence. I see it, staff members see it. But it is, that's definitely a challenge for us, but we do have signage now.
Mm-hmm. And also, I noticed that there were some, older drinking fountains out there that didn't seem to operate. Are we going to be removing those from the park, at the Olivera Park?
Drinking fountains is a challenge for us throughout. I don't know if we have an identified a plan for the ones at Olivera. I would imagine those ones would be repaired. We do have other ones that end up getting capped, basically concrete over the top. It just depends on our ability to make repairs on that drinking fountain and the cost related to that. We have some fountains on the rail trail, for example, that are decorative that are very expensive when they break, and they do break. It really to kind of identifying the costs and our ability to fund that. And then on that side of things, that would be out of the district there.
I'm not sure the usage. I guess for me, if I were a parent, I'd be very concerned about my child or anyone in my family drinking out of a public faucet that's not cleaned and maintained on a daily basis. So, you know, for hygiene's sake, that's what I'm thinking about. For the city is that, you know, this could cause a problem. And we have hard water here in Los Banos. It's just street water coming through there. And so you're going to have that calcium and hard water stuff build up that's just going to ruin any product that we may put there. And even if we replace it, it's going to build up again. You can't stay ahead of that. So that's just kind of my opinion on it. You know, for health and safety's sake, I don't see that as an asset to our community. The other thing is, and I think the mayor brought it up about Big Page Park, but I noticed park number 6 on Birch and I has some fencing around it. I don't know if it's under repair or things are going to be replaced. I also noticed that that particular park has sand for the base around the equipment and some other side areas. And you know, there's a lot of growth there of grass, you know, dogs go in there and, you know, do their business. And I'm just kind of wondering how healthy that is, you know, for kids out there playing in the sand. And I see parents bringing their kids there, and I'm sure that that's something that they may not be thinking of at the time. But this year I noticed there's a significant amount of grass growing up through the sand. So with that, as we make replacements in our park, what type of materials are we using to go at the base of the equipment?
Sand is an acceptable form. There's sand, there's playground chips, which are ADA, and you see like the pour in place that you might see in other communities. I think we might have some of our school sites, but I don't think we have any of our park sites here. But you might go to another community and see a rubbery hard surface. That's another option. As far as that's Gardens 3 is the Birch and I Street park that she's referencing there. That's one of two parks that has sand. The other one, Citrus 1, which will be getting replaced. And when we replace it, we will be going to CHIPS. The reason why is because CHIPS is easier to maintain from a maintenance standpoint. And so we will be looking at that. The fencing for Gardens 3, that was a playground repair that we were finalizing. And I know it talked with the mayor here about that we had some issues with cars pulling into that park and things like that. So we were looking at some signage for that. But the sand, as far as grass coming up, that needs to be removed and taken care of. So we'll have staff take a look at that. And just kind of a point on the pouring place surfacing. You see that in other communities. It's very expensive to put in, very easy after it's put in, but also an asset that you have to replace over a 10 to 15 year period. So
this is the rubbery tartan type material.
Yeah, sometimes you see it just under swing sets, and sometimes you see the whole area. So for example, at Pacheco Park, we a playground that we submitted for the grant, we put in pour in place surface, and that's because it's right next to a splash pad, and we didn't want the wood chips getting wet and getting, you know, stuck to people's feet and walking over to the splash pad and clogging up things and being not fun. So okay. Yeah.
The mayor brought up about the dog park, you know, the council did in its approval of that make a part of the motion that it be completed within the fiscal year ending of 2020. Will this council be seeing your finalized plan of the dog park before we move forward?
If that's something that you would like to, anybody would like to request, absolutely.
I think at least if maybe you can give the city manager copies of the finalization and they could just desktop it for us to look at, that would be a nice
thing. Absolutely, yeah.
Okay. And then lastly, under tree maintenance, you know, I know we've got a lot of trees in Los Banos, some that are far past their lifespan, probably still some dead ones around. But in regards to maintenance, I know we have the CCID trail, we've got the rail trail and all the parks and wherever else trees need to be replaced or planted. In this process of the tree development plan, is there going to be a feeding as well as a regular trimming of trees if those particular trees require certain trimming? I know that I've gotten a call and still working on it from a resident off the CCID canal about, you know, just a very small portion of a tree that's hanging over their backyard. And so I don't know whether those trees had ever been trimmed on the canal or not. So I'm just wondering in this tree maintenance program, if it includes all the trees that are on public property or property that we've agreed to maintain.
So as far as the tree master plan goes, it would be inventory for all trees, public and non-public trees. But as far as and it would provide recommendations for maintenance and care. However, one of the biggest challenges we have is funding, of course, is staff time, of course. So where we're at today without that plan is looking at these trees at a case-by-case basis, is looking at them first and foremost from a safety hazard basis. Those are really the two biggest things that factor into tree work that we put in currently. There are funding elements within, for example, the districts that provide for some tree care, and that's where you see some of the palm trees and other trees that get taken care of. I know up in College Green, they get College Greens, we treat them. That does require some funding as far as that goes. But yes, I'm hoping that the tree master plan will kind of give us that path towards it. But yeah, it would be for all public trees.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much.
Yeah. You know, we have electrical outlets where trees were cut down in the downtown. Can we get those replaced? So at least during Christmas time, we can have consistency so there isn't a gap between that.
Yeah, typically the guys check it out before, so I'll bring it up with them again here, our staff here. But yeah, typically we'd review them, but we'll bring out an electrician to check
the. Well, the electrician's out, fine. There's no tree. You cut it down.
Yeah. Well, so, for the few spots that don't have trees anymore, yes.
So yeah. Okay, so we'll replace those.
If we have funding allows. Well, but yes.
I mean, the downtown is our show place. And you know, I don't know if anyone would disagree on this council, but we've got to maintain that. And so the tree had been cut down several years ago, and I think it's time to replace it.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Mr. Jones.
Oh, just going back to the trees on downtown. You know, I think the biggest thing we need to figure out, which is going into our next agenda item, is figuring out what we're actually going to do with the layout of downtown, sidewalks, things like that, before we start throwing trees in that we may end up taking out because they're put out blocking a storefront or something like that. So last thing we want to do is block the view of any building from the street, because sometimes you get down the street and you can't see any of the stores there. They're hidden behind the trees. So those are things we need to take in consideration when we're planting new trees. Are they in the right spot, or are we just throwing them based on spacing when we put them in? So, and then any of those electrical outlets, we should have some really good locks on them.
Yeah,
too, as well. So,
yeah, it's definitely something that I know we've talked about with Mark before, as far as the downtown trees go, and I've discussed with the tree commission as well. But yeah, it's certainly as we get plans for downtown, that would be very important to be able to review that. And as far as the outlets, of course, trying to secure them as best as we can.
And I know those constantly get broken too. I mean, it's an ongoing issue.
Yeah.
So thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. Mrs. Lewis?
Yeah, just piggybacking on Councilmember Jones. I think as we move further into downtown, the revitalization, which is, you know, the next project we're going to hear, I think one of the things that we've discussed is, you know, possibly potting trees rather than planting them in the ground, because there is one tree that I notice down on the corner of it's on the north west corner of I and 7th Street, that's in the ground, and it's got the pavers around there, but the pavers are all popped up because the tree roots have gotten out of sort. So those are things I think in the long run that this council wants to address as far as the trees are concerned in our downtown area, just whether or not it's more feasible to put them in the ground or put them in a nice pot of some sort. That way they can be controlled.
Yeah, I think it's a valuable point to look at.
So. I just want a tree. Replace a stump. Okay. Any other questions? Okay, thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Let's go on to item number 10. Consideration and approval of City Council Resolution number 6180, adopting the Los Banos Downtown Strategic Plan. And who's going to introduce this? Stacy, go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and City Council. So tonight we are asking the City Council to consider adopting the Los Banos Downtown Strategic Plan. As you may recall, we've held a stakeholder meeting, there was a community workshop, and then there was also back in September a joint planning commission and City Council study session where we presented to the Council and Planning Commission an overview of the project and the various strategies that we were proposing within. So based on the feedback that we received from the joint study session, that's been incorporated into the strategic plan, and now I'm going to turn it over to Joanna Jansen and Bruce Brubaker from PlaceWorks, and they'll be presenting a PowerPoint for you tonight.
Thank you and welcome.
Thank you. Stacy mentioned my name is Joanna Jansen. I am a principal with PlaceWorks. We're the firm who's leading your general plan update, and I'm helping Stacy to manage that work. General plans, as I know we've talked about with you before, are by definition a long-range vision for your community. But at the same time, we really saw an opportunity here in Los Banos at the outset of the general plan update to take some steps even before the formal adoption of the general plan itself to keep things moving and to capture some of the momentum that we were already seeing on some of the very key topics of importance to this council and to the community. And one of those is a downtown revitalization and ongoing improvements downtown and support for local businesses downtown. So as part of the overall general plan update project, in addition to the long-range planning and policy work that's going into that, we also wanted to take some specific concrete steps right now to demonstrate progress and to help set the city up to be able to take advantage of current conditions and make sure that we're not waiting another 20 years to see things emerge and change downtown. So that's was the genesis of the downtown strategic planning process as one component of the overall general plan update, and that's the piece of the project that we're here to present to you tonight. Bruce Brubaker, another principal from my office, has really taken the lead role on that very focused work. He brings a much more of a greater expertise in urban design and architecture than I have. My work tends to be at a larger scale. So we brought Bruce in to bring his perspective to the downtown planning process. And I'm going to turn this over to him to describe the strategic plan and the changes that we've incorporated since our last conversation with you.
Welcome, Bruce. Thank you, Joanna. I'm glad we inserted that appropriately. Well, it's nice to be back in Los Banos, and we were at the another workshop last night, and I had a very pleasant day today in Los Banos, going to the 6th Street Cafe for breakfast and working in town. So. And tonight I'm happy to present the downtown's, it's a draft, strategic plan, but we have got it to the point where we feel it's finalized. Could you start the presentation?
It should be gone. Should be all
right. Okay.
Same situation. Yeah. There we go.
Good. See, that's easy. So tonight the presentation is a very brief overview of the strategic plan, and then I'll discuss the additions and changes that happened from the September Planning Commission City Council study session we had in September. I'm going to keep the overview very brief because we at that meeting, which was a study session of both the council and the commission, we gave a very detailed chapter by chapter, section by section overview of the plan. So I won't do that tonight, but I will talk in some detail about the changes. So this is the study area for the plan, the strategic plan area, extending from I along the rail trail out to Pacheco Boulevard and centered around 6th Street and the heart of downtown along 6th Street. Three public outreach and engagement components to the planning effort, which included a stakeholder meeting of downtown interests, business interests, and others, and then an open public community workshop in the community center, and then the study session. These are the overall topics that are in the downtown plan. There's 10 of them. I won't read them out right here, but I would, this is another slide that shows the topics that were discussed, and we made some changes or additions to those sections given the study session. So the highlights in blue and the sections that we really entered into and made changes to include implement gateways and wayfinding, strengthen businesses, rehabilitate buildings, improve safety, develop a food scene, And we also added an implementation matrix in the back of the strategy. So I'll go through those one by one and what the changes were. To implement gateways and wayfinding, this is some images that we showed at that meeting and that are also in the plan. This is from Pacheco Boulevard, looking down 6th Street, and hearing from many stakeholders and others that a lot of people pass by on Pacheco and don't realize that there is a downtown as close by and as nice a downtown as it is close by to all those people passing by. So can there be, should there be additional signage and gateway features leading to downtown? And the consensus we heard from the study session is yes, there should be some focus on additional wayfinding and gateway features. So our chapter or section regarding this has some existing components that we presented to you at that time, including things like create gateway features at major downtown access points that include 6th, but also at the I Street or H Street connection with Pacheco as well. So those coming from the east can turn there, and those coming from the west could turn at 6th. Also to implement wayfinding signage in the downtown to help people find points of interest in downtown, and also parking, public parking in downtown. To that, and after some discussion, we've added some new text and imagery about the gateways and wayfinding, including a full page text box in the plan regarding gateways and wayfinding, and so some more guidance about that. And we also included some additional captions to describe the images that we did have in the plan to fully illustrate the gateway and archway options. The next section we addressed was strengthen businesses and some of the existing strategies, and there's more than these, but some of the highlights are to really look for achieving a mix of critical mass of restaurants, retail, entertainment, and lodging. So a good mix of businesses, or better mix of businesses than you have now, and to also collaborate with the local business organizations. And we know there's efforts going to create a business district and to get stakeholders fully involved in you know, marketing and selling the downtown in a more efficient way. We've added two new strategies to this. So one is to, and I'll just read this off, to evaluate the potential for adopting a system to manage the mix and numbers of downtown business types to ensure a diverse mix of businesses. So that's a system to manage the mix of businesses in downtown. The next strategy would be to evaluate which land uses should be subject to discretionary approval to best achieve a vibrant and diverse business mix, and to adopt changes to the municipal code to require conditional use permits for those uses. So we're not proposing changes right now, but we are proposing that there be a discussion that perhaps planning department can do some thinking and come back to council for some recommendations for perhaps changing the permitting process for businesses downtown to ensure that you get the right mix of businesses that you think is appropriate in downtown. So you could, for instance, change a certain type of business use from a by right permit to a conditional use permit, so it would need a public hearing to be approved, for example. I'm happy to answer any of the questions, or there could be other discussion at the end of my presentation. The next section is to rehabilitate buildings. And there's a lot of great historic buildings downtown. Some of them need to be buffed up and improved and shown to great advantage, but there is a lot of good structures in your downtown. So some of our strategies are to fix up and build upon Los Banos historic assets, to enhance the small town feel in downtown, and to use state and local programs to promote rehabilitation. We've added two strategies To consider reducing on-site parking requirements for existing structures, because that does inhibit reuse of some structures if they cannot provide on or off-street parking to fill a structure. So consider the use of flexible parking requirements, and to also allow flexibility to subdivide existing structures to create separate front rear spaces and access. So in some cases, and I think we showed an example of an alleyway that could be developed into a nicer pedestrian friendly space. There would be an opportunity then for direct access from the rear of the building to the alleyway. So making that more flexible to subdivide and permit those spaces might be a good asset for downtown.
So the consider reducing on-site parking, and I understand when you talked about the alleyway and developing that, are there any other areas that you're thinking about in regards to reducing parking? Because, you know, we have limited parking as it is downtown. And so I'm concerned as to
no, we did hear that message very clearly that there's a concern about parking. So mm-hmm. We were not considering that there'd be an expansion of this flexible parking arrangement. It would only be for specific uses, and there would probably need to be some kind of permitting process that was would consider the benefits and the drawbacks of doing that. We do have a whole section now. We didn't change or add strategies to it given the discussion we had in September, but there is a section in the downtown strategy plan that addresses parking. So there's a whole parking section in there. And some of those, I can go to the parking section and mention a couple of the other strategies that we have there, if I can find it. Hang on a second. Okay. So some of the strategies that we have under parking, develop and install clear, visually appealing parking signage based on best practices of other cities. Because there are a lot of parking resources in downtown, it's just that maybe people don't know where they are exactly. So you can strengthen that connection. To conduct a parking study for downtown to identify you could even do an occupancy study to see where the most impacted areas are and then make recommendations about how to improve that. We also, as part of that, would recommend looking at ways to manage parking. And some of those ways might be to put two-hour parking limits in certain areas, typically on street. And these would only be consideration, for your consideration. So these are all strategies that could be considered to improve, the way parking is either, supplied or managed to ensure that there's enough parking for downtown.
Okay, and then I'd like to back up a little bit under the strengthening businesses.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess in our booklet, it's page 20, letter S, where you talk about evaluate the land use usage should be subject to discretionary approval to best achieve a vibrant and diverse business mix.
Mm-hmm.
Could under the discretionary approval is where I'm struggling a little bit, but could you share it with us a little bit how you see this going or what your thoughts are on this?
Well, if there's a certain business type that you're concerned about, and many cities have these, land use requirements for, say, liquor stores, right, mm-hmm. where there's a conditional use permit required for that use, and anyone who applies for that land use has to go through a process that's determined by the city, and it generally includes planning commission review, and that's a public hearing. So that is a discretionary permit for that use. you could consider applying that discretionary permit for other uses besides liquor stores. So if you have some businesses that you're, you know, have some concern about in downtown, you could make a, you know, you could even limit the discretionary use. So in downtown, that use would require a conditional use permit. So that's, it's a tool that council and commission can use to kind of adjust the mix of businesses in downtown.
So with that being said, if, well, for me, if I have concerns that there may be too many of a type of business in our downtown area that may not be conducive to having a vibrancy in our downtown, does that fall under this, or do we have to have specific land use ordinances to control something like that?
Well, that is something that may take a little more thought, and it may take some thought from the city attorney to see what the, you know, if there are any drawbacks to putting a quota on a certain type of land use. And I'm not sure, I'm not an attorney, so I'm not sure what the legal implications of that are, and maybe there aren't any. So I do know that some cities have tried and do regulate, for instance, the number of fast food restaurants in a downtown. So, you know, there has been examples done where quotas have been made. So you could consider that, but I would recommend that you do that in concert with your city attorney. So there could be a recommendation to explore that. And in a way, that's what our strategy does. It says, evaluate the potential. And so that's an encouragement for planning staff and others to really look and see what the issues are, to discuss them, and then to return to council or commission and say, here's our recommendation.
Okay. Because we do have a diversity of what we have to offer in our community from 6th Street versus I Street. And in order to bring those communities together so we have a truly vibrant downtown, I see that there has to be some change going on at mm-hmm. some point.
Mm-hmm.
And it may not be a business going out of business, but how the business may be upscaled or offer more amenities to the community so that it's a better fit for the
downtown. Yeah, so right. This is interesting, and it's also a new, maybe an additional aspect that, because, you know, in terms of land use mix and approval and permitting, we're talking about controlling or adjusting or managing uses that are coming in, right? New uses that want to move to downtown. And so if you're talking about existing uses that are already there and ways to manage that, that kind of fits more in the code compliance side. And you know, there are, you know, some tools that you can use to manage nuisance uses and other things like that. So I think that's a little bit of a different aspect than, and you might want to do both these things, right? It sounds like there's an interest in figuring out which uses are desired in downtown and which ones are concerns, and let's figure out how to permit those. That's one way. And the other way, simultaneously or in parallel, let's figure out what to do with existing businesses that are there now.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Okay.
Why don't we go ahead?
Well, it's in the book, and what this book does is give, momentum, especially since we've got an action matrix and we've put priorities in that action matrix. This strengthened business policy is a priority in the action matrix. So this will give some momentum to staff and others to make, you know, this happen. So
I'd like to see a finished component with that.
It's important that that we have a balanced downtown. And if we're going to go to all to this extent, I think it's important that, yes, as Mrs. Lewis said, that we have a balanced downtown and we look at our land use. So thank you.
Okay. Now, let's see. And Stacy, you could add to any of the things that I'm saying if it sounds appropriate. So let's see. I have a few more to go through. I'm close to the completion, but under rehabilitate buildings, there's another one that we added, which came about given, you know, the poor condition of some of the housing in downtown. And so we added this strategy. There's some existing strategies we already had to address some of those code compliance issues, but this one says to potentially partner with nonprofits to buy substandard buildings, for the nonprofits to buy substandard buildings with residential units and leverage outside funds to rehabilitate them into safe, well-managed housing. So that's an additional strategy that could be considered from the city. And there's considerable funding coming in to local use from state programs, and some of those might be used in this fashion. So there could be additional resources in the future to do things like this. Under the section improve safety, we have lots of strategies in there, including to create family-friendly evening events, venues, and activities, and to use environmental design to deter crime, SEPTED principles. Those are already in the book. We've added this new strategy to convene a panel or commission to address Los Banos's homelessness issues and recommend best practices. So that's something that could be considered. Under developed food scene, we heard there was a fair amount of discussion about some of the strategies we had there, including to establish new markets and restaurants featuring local food, to foster outdoor eating spaces, and this not a new strategy, but an amended strategy to encourage and allow for food trucks, including through municipal code revisions. And that stemmed from our discussion that we had about food trucks being maybe a food truck festival being a good idea and potentially a recurring festival, but that's under your current ordinance not allowed. So perhaps revising the ordinance to allow for an ongoing regular every other Friday or every Friday food truck festival, that type of thing. So that is an additional strategy we added.
Okay. Yes, go ahead.
Thank you. And I want to back up again one more time to the upgrade of the infrastructure.
Okay.
I see under, I'm sorry, improve safety.
Yeah.
It would be, well, there's letters A, B, C, and then it goes down to number one where it talks about increased foot and bicycle traffic on streets in the downtown of Los Banos.
Mm-hmm.
Foot traffic, I'm okay with. I'm a little bit uneasy with bicycle traffic because we don't have, you know, large cities like metropolitans where you have enough street width to do that kind of stuff. And with the amount of with the type of parking that we have, although bicyclists can be on any public street as long as they obey the laws,
yeah,
it's not, our downtown is not conducive for that. And we certainly have issues, you know, with skateboarders and bicycle riders riding on our public sidewalks, and we don't want to encourage that.
Yeah.
So I don't see that as something at this particular time that's going to be viable for our downtown. So I don't know about the other council members, but I think that's a feature that we need to look at perhaps taking out.
Mm-hmm.
In regards to the food trucks, you know, we passed an ordinance here several years ago about food trucks, especially with our public parks. I don't know whether that extended to the downtown area, but for me, I just want to make sure, because when other cities have food truck vending, they bring in all types of cuisine. And, yeah. and we need to be cognizant of that, to bring in more than one cuisine if we're going to have that. And that it's going to be something that's going to enhance the merchants downtown. Not just benefiting the food trucks, because mm-hmm. the merchants are there, they're there permanently. And I don't want to see anything that's going to distract from them. So that planning has to be very well thought out, and not in a way that's going to take away from our businesses that already exist in the downtown area.
If I may, I do recall the discussion, something similar like to what you're saying in the September meeting, and a goal to not have your standard food truck at this kind of event, but to have a variety of cuisine types.
Yeah, and Clovis has a situation where they have right. food trucks on a regular basis, and we need to, be in the position of perhaps setting up some times where we can invite other vendors from other areas to come down and bring their cuisine into our town, so that you can have that vibrancy of the downtown that we're looking to build in Los Banos. But again, I want to make sure that the mix is appropriate with our business people who inhabit storefronts, and not be a distraction from them. And we just have people going to food trucks and they're not participating with our merchants downtown. And that's all that I have for right now on those two things.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, that brings up a point. Hopefully,
you had mentioned something about bicycles and skateboards. Well, for right now, I think temporarily, what we need to do is restripe on the corners, because we used to have those symbols that said no bikes and no skateboards, and they've kind of worn off. So maybe, for in the interim right now, we could have those or put back on or painted back in the with the logos for no bikes and no skateboards on the corners. So because they're kind of worn off over the years.
So just to clarify, that would be a stencil on the sidewalk.
Stencil
right?
on the sidewalk.
No bikes on the sidewalk, because bikes yeah. would be allowed in the street.
Yes. Right? Yeah. Yes. But the sidewalk, it just brought up a point, and we talked about that. The stencils on the sidewalks have worn out, and they need to be put back on.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. Should I continue? Thank you for your comments. So that was food trucks. And we added some imagery for what, the food truck festival could look like in downtown. That is now in the book. And then we added this action matrix, and this is just one page, the first page of the action matrix, which talks about the category it's in, the section, whether it's, develop a food scene or, strengthen business. And then the strategies underneath that. Potential partners that could help assist the city, or the city could work with partners, and then kind of the cost and time frame for the strategy. And in the matrix that we've included in the plan itself, we did highlight many of the strategies, or hopefully all of the strategies that were prioritized in our last study session, that are highlighted in the kind of a buff color. And so these would be ones that would be especially noted to be done, or action to be taken soon. So so with that concludes my presentation, and I'm happy to answer any further questions.
And that's all located on our website?
It will be.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Okay.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Any other questions? Mr. Freya?
I'll just comment. I like your action to be taken soon.
Uh-huh. Okay. Thanks. Okay.
Yeah, we've done a lot of talking for a lot of years.
You're welcome. Mr. Jones?
We actually get to the design concepts for sidewalks and landscaping, those items here. So I know this strategic plan. It's more of like the boilerplate stuff, but when do we actually get to see designs, you know, if we're going to do bulbs out there in the corners or any of these parklets, or start talking about if we're going to restrict any uses downtown, things like that. When will we get to that?
Sure. So we would be taking from these strategies, the priorities, and implementing those tasks. So in regards to parking, one of the strategies is doing a parking study. We need to determine whether there's a particular use that impacts parking, whether the amount of public parking that we have is sufficient, whether we need more, whether we need a limit. So we need to know what our parking situation is first and then design parking from that. So where appropriate parklets, or we're also working with a Pacheco specific plan that may adjust possibly roadways, and that could affect downtown. And with that, maybe that wouldn't be an opportunity for us to fix just the circulation of how downtown works. So I think we have a lot of opportunities there, but we need to start with understanding what we have. So that would be to address parking. And then to address the land uses, we would need to, as Bruce said, get into the zoning code. And so we'd need to evaluate whether, you know, there's some undesirable uses, or there's an overconcentration of a particular type of use that needs to have some sort of discretionary permit, so needs a conditional use permit process. We'd work with the city attorney on that. In addition to that, another strategy, like Bruce said, would be to look at the mixture of uses. But then, in the nuisance, the code compliance side of things, I think that would address Councilmember Lewis's concern about the existing businesses and really just quality, you know, taking that up a notch. We could address that with signage. We could address that just with appearance, rehabilitation, those sorts of things into the existing businesses. But I think it's going to be taking these strategies and forming a plan to implement them, determine which ones we're going to do first, and just start doing them, taking action on those plans. I'd say probably one of our first tasks that we've talked about for a while now, as long as that I've been within the Community and Economic Development Department, has been evaluating the land uses. And so I would hope that that would be probably one of the top on our list to get into first.
Do we have a time frame of when we might start evaluating these and doing like the parking surveys? Because even on like a parking study, that's kind of a fluid thing, because depending on what businesses come in, like a restaurant, if you have a full restaurant, you're going to require a little bit more parking than if you have like, say, a bookstore where you might have a couple customers at a time. So I always say we can never have enough parking. So
Alex, did you want to add something?
Just a process check. What we're recommending tonight to the council is to adopt the strategic plan, and then at a future date, we would come back to the council with an implementation matrix, an implementation plan based on the recommendations contained in the strategy. So that's kind of the process we had been thinking about at the staff level, and that's kind of wrapped up into our recommendation this evening.
Okay, I just don't want this to sit on a shelf, and 5 years down the road, we don't see anything from it. So I want to make sure that we're actively working on it, and we have, at some point down the road, we can get those pavers out of storage and put them in their permanent home on the sidewalk, so.
Absolutely. Much of the plan is funding dependent, so that's part of the consideration as we move forward with the our implementation recommendations to use the council.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well,
Stacy, then, can we do what we can now to take care of the things that, you know, the things that we can pick off now? With signage, with beautification, things that we're able to do without waiting for the full implementation.
So next step, we would need to prioritize. We would need to do that with the council, and then based on those priorities, we'd need to budget for them.
Okay.
So this has not been budgeted for. So we would take those priorities and work with the finance department to build that into the budget.
Okay.
To have a plan, an action plan.
You guys good?
Yeah, thank you.
All right, let's get it done. just one other comment. We only have 5 years on the P-bid right now, and we have to show some progress in the downtown or else they're not going to re-up that. So it's important that we work hand in hand to get this done, because people are that are paying this money into these properties are going to have to see something for a value. So
it's great news you have the P-bid.
Pardon me?
It's great news you have the P-bid.
Yes. Yes. All right. Mr. Free, you want to make a motion?
Yes, I would. I would move to adopt the City Council Resolution Number 6180, adopting the Las Banas Downtown Strategic Plan.
Mrs. Santos.
Second.
Motion by Farias, second by Santos, to adopt Resolution Number 6180. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposition? None carried. Okay, let's go on to item 11, report regarding potential IT data breach. Incident summary and consideration of approval, City Council Resolution Number 6181, adopting a revised budget for the 2019-2020 fiscal year as it pertains to related expenditures. And we are going to go to Director Williams.
Thank you, Mayor. Good evening, Mayor and Council members. As you are aware, we recently learned that a city-owned password-protected laptop was stolen from an employee's vehicle. Upon discovering the incident, the city launched an investigation, which included reporting it to our insurance, working with specialized attorneys, data recovery consultants, and breach notification consultants to insist in fixing the situation. The contents of the laptop were recreated to show the data that was on there, and that data was then reviewed to identify any individuals whose personal information may have been contained in those files. At this point in time, we are not aware of any fraud or identity theft to any of the people that were contained in those files. And we do not know if any personal information was ever actually viewed by the unauthorized party. Additionally, we do not believe that the data stored on the laptop was a target of the theft. The information for each person the information for each person impacted differs and may include your social security number, your passport, your address, or your medical information. Each letter might vary. However, there is a phone number if anybody has any questions or concerns, a call center that they can call, and that phone number I can give out is 1-844-902-2030, and they can help with any further information. Again, I just want to make it clear that we did all this as a precautionary item. We're not aware of any files actually being stolen or accessed. The laptop is password protected, so they would have to get past the password in order to get to this information. It is not encrypted, which would be a secondary feature. The encryption would then require some secondary software to access those files, so that's why we are in this situation, because although it is password protected, it is not encrypted. So part of what we've done is, some of you will notice if you have been affected, if your information is potentially in that computer, you would have received a notice of data breach. And that includes information like a brief summary of what happened and what we're doing to fix the situation. But most importantly, it talks about what you can do now at this point to help ensure that there's no identity theft. And we are offering a 12-month Experian credit monitoring. You do have to until April to sign up for this credit monitoring. If you receive the notice, there is a special activation code assigned to you that you will need. I went and did it just to see how easy it is, and it's fairly simple. You go in there, you do have to enter some personal information, your name, your address, you do have to enter your social security number, and then they will ask you security features such as, have you applied for this type of credit in the last 12 months? Do you know any of the people on this list? What county do you live in? So you do have to answer, I think it was 4 or 5 questions to sign up. But the benefit of that is that they will monitor your credit for 1 year. And if you are able, if you can sign up on the computer, then you can access your credit report on a daily basis free of charge. If you can't sign up on a computer and you do it through the telephone, then you can access, a data report can be sent to you on a monthly basis. Again, they will monitor your credit. They will check Experian, Equifax, and TransUnion. And if anything does happen, then they do offer identity restoration support. And so I do believe it's up to $1 million in identity theft insurance if you do sign up for this. Again, it is until April 26, 2020, and you have 12 months from the date that you sign up. Additionally, we have changed procedures for backing up city systems to ensure that this doesn't happen again. We are currently revamping policies regarding use of mobile devices to ensure that this doesn't happen. We have already put into place a technology called BitLocker, and what this does is basically encrypt any mobile device that we have. We are also looking at options for tracking mobile devices and or being able to wipe out mobile devices. So if this incident happened again, we can remotely erase everything that was on a cell phone, a laptop, or any type of tablet. Additionally, unfortunately, I mean, fortunately, we have insurance, which is fantastic, but we do have a insurance deductible that we have to pay, and that's in the amount of $50,000, and that's what that budget request is in front of you tonight. The $50,000 will be split between the general fund and the enterprise funds in the same manner that we pay the premium. So it ends up being about $38,000 to the general funds and $12,000 split between the three different enterprise funds. And with this $50,000, we pay $50,000, but we are covered up to $1 million for this incident. So that will pay for the, it actually paid for the attorney, it paid for them to review the data files, and it's paying for the credit monitoring, the notices, and the call center. So I'd be happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Okay. Mrs. Lewis?
Thank you. Sonia, the $1 million coverage, is that in total or is that per person that's affected?
So the $1 million coverage for our insurance policy mm-hmm. is in total. Okay. If you sign up for the credit monitoring, then it's for each individual person that signs up.
Okay, so
it's two separate debt okay. things, yes.
All right, that's what I want to clarify. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions? Okay. If not, do I have a motion? Mrs. Lewis.
Oh, let me get my, sorry. I'd like to make a motion to approve the report regarding the data breach summary, resolution number 6181 as read by title.
Mr. Freya.
I'll second that motion.
Okay. Motion by Lewis, second by Freya to approve City Council resolution number 6181. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition? None carried. Okay. Let's go on to item 12, advisement of public notices. And there's no report tonight. And let's go on to city manager's report, item number 13.
Nothing this evening, Mayor. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, let's go on to report update, Merced County Association of Governments, MCAG, and Measure V Committee. Well, I have to tell you that we are very fortunate to have a man by the name of Dan McElhaney, who is the District 10 Director for Caltrans. He has succeeded where others have not taken action on the safety of 152. So how does this relate to MCAG? We are holding monthly safety meetings with Caltrans and his staff to improve the traffic flow on 152. And this is separate from the Pioneer Project that we've been talking about. So what's been happening? The Highway 152 committee is meeting monthly at the community center, and our second meeting took place in February. No, where was it? In January, right? Is that what it was?
Sure.
Yeah, I think January. Okay. All right. So what we discovered is it's $1.1 million that's needed to sync all the stoplights and for some additional signage is a little bit extra. So Caltrans now is looking at the sinking of the stoplights because they have to have new transmitters and then some trenching too. So we figured it's about to, and Mark already had the estimate. Thank you, Mark, which was spot on, $1.1 million. So Caltrans needs to look for this money in order to increase the traffic flow on 152. Also, there are 17 intersections that the city of Los Banos and Caltrans will be looking at within the city limits of Los Banos. And what can we do at each intersection to make sure that it's not impeding traffic? So that was one of the assignments that Caltrans and Mark's office is looking at. So it also will help the traffic flow on 152. The District 10 director, again, we thank him for his support and his staff. He's been a real champion for us in improving 152 traffic and safety flow. And I also want to thank Alex, Gary, Mason, Mark, and Matt from MCAG for their input, because without it, we would not have a cohesive group. So we are meeting monthly. The Caltrans staff comes down from Stockton, and they are meeting with our staff. So I can't thank them enough. And we have two things going. We have the Pioneer Trail, and now we have the Safety Committee on 152. Brett, thank you for attending the last meeting. So with that, that's all I have to report tonight. And we're going to continue these meetings, and hopefully we can improve the traffic flow on 152. So that's all I have. So let's go on to item. Any questions? Anything?
No, thanks.
Okay. All right. Let's go on to item 15, City Council Member Reports. Tonight we'll start with Mr. Faria.
Thank you, Mayor. I want to thank the fire department and local in our Merced County who cooked chickens for our choir fundraiser one more time. 350 dinners we did. I'm still kind of trying to run my program at a distance. And I have a very fine young man. I want to mention his name. His name is Devin Rodney. And he was a graduate of Los Banos High School. He's a music, got his music education degree. He's working on his credential. He's subbing for me. So my students don't have a babysitter. They actually have a music teacher, which is a big advantage to us. And he is one of our finest graduates and showing exactly how wonderful our kids, when they grow up, can be. So I want to thank Devin and everyone else who's keeping me going, and my wife for tending me. And now I am going to, as my final comments, I'm going to slip out because I'm about done for the evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let's go on to Mrs. Santos.
Thank you. I just want to say I was born in Kansas City, so go Chiefs. But those are my comments for tonight. Thank you.
All right, cut her off. Is that your only comment tonight?
That's my only comment. Oh. Thank you.
Okay. Any problem, counsel, if I go on to someone else right now? Okay. Thank you, Deronica. Okay, let's go on to Mr. Jones.
No report.
Okay, thank you so much. Mrs. Lewis.
Nothing to report except to echo Mrs. Santos's statement.
What? Okay. All right, I've made my comments, and I'm still a California boy. So, sorry, Niners. Okay, so with that, we're going to go on to closed session, conference with legal counsel, anticipated litigation, initiation of litigation pursuant to paragraph 4, subsection D of the Government Code, section 54956.9, one potential case. If we have anything to report, we will do so when we return. Thank you and have a nice evening.